含蓄，持重内秀是他的处世理念，医学智慧，人类健康是他的终极目标。在这座造福人类的医学圣殿里，红细胞沉降率横空出世，大规模生产纯净胰岛素的方法从无到有。在这个缔造健康奇迹的摇篮里，世界上第一台伽马刀应运而生，世界上第一台心脏起搏器震撼问世。众多石破天惊的医学发现，使它成为诺贝尔生理学和医学奖的评审地。从实验室到手术室，它为捍卫人类的健康不遗余力。从医学的专门领域到科学的整个世界，它始终以踏实沉稳的脚步，承载着厚重持久的学术力量。
瑞典著名导演伯格曼曾说过，斯德哥尔摩最不像一个城市，它是原野湖泊和建筑物的结晶。沿着鹅卵石铺就的古堡小街，追寻700年来的历史脉络，远眺四周蔚蓝的大海，静观悠闲垂钓的人群，方能体会这北方威尼斯的精妙之处。诗意的美景催生出智慧的灵魂，天才诺贝尔就是在这里诞生。从1901年开始，一年一度的诺贝尔奖颁奖仪式，让斯德哥尔摩的冬天充满无尽的激情和渴望。
One fortunate thing for our university was when Alfred Nobel, in the end of the 1890s,in the end of the 1890s, wrote his will. And gave the task to the Karolinska Institute to award the Nobel Prize in physiology and medicine. And that task has really helped our university and to work on the absolute top level of the international research front. Since then, we have had to review what's going on in all different fields in medicine and physiology.
在1808年俄瑞战争中，许多战士能够从战场幸存，却因为医疗水平的低下而死于感染。在国王查理十三世的号召下，1810年，卡罗林斯卡医学院得以创建。目的就是为了用教育、科研和信息来增益人类健康。从创建伊始，卡罗林斯卡医学院就占据了关照人类福祉和生命的制高点。卡罗林斯卡医学院如同乘风破浪的航船，在世界医学的广袤海洋里驶出了自己的一片天地。
It's like a whole town.Just a medical university, and I think that what you get from it is that you get the broad aspect, you get the broad approach to research, because you can include almost anything in the Karolinska, and that I think is a very good situation, actually. So whatever you'd want to do, whatever.Speciality or aspect you want to study, you could go to another group at the Karolinska, because most of what's happening you can find here. And I think that's an advantage.
每个学生呢，在这儿都得到了很大的提高，从原来知道的很少，最后呢，能达到一个非常成熟的独立的科研工作者，最后能走向世界各国。所以我觉得这是卡林斯卡最突出的一点。
卡罗林斯卡医学院其校徽的主要图案是一条盘旋在权杖上的蛇。在希腊神话中，医神阿斯寇雷波就是手持这样一根蛇杖，云游四方治病救人。卡罗林斯卡医学院的每一名教员和学生都以医神为榜样。1915年，弗雷乌斯发现了红细胞沉降率， 1930年前后，约尔佩斯教授研究出大规模生产纯净胰岛素的方法。1958年，奥克森宁医师将世界上第一个心脏起搏器植入人体。1968年，雷克塞尔教授研制出世界上第一台伽马刀。此外，卡罗林斯卡医学院还曾有八人先后获得了诺贝尔医学奖。
At that time, we had studied the structures of the prostaglandins. In my research, we have always tried to combine things with each other. So, in this case, we started with the biological activity of prostaglandins and worked using chemical methods. We worked out the structures.And when we worked out the structures, we applied old organic chemical methods with modern mass spectrometry, which was actually being developed at that time. So it was a combination of two fields that resulted in the structures of the prostaglandin.
久负盛名的历史声誉、雄厚优越的师资力量，还有宁静踏实的研究氛围，使卡罗林斯卡医学院备受有才之士的青睐。本特·塞缪尔森就是在隆德大学毕业后，跟随老师贝里斯特伦来到这里，一起参与分离和鉴定前列腺素的工作。经过20多年艰苦卓绝的努力，前列腺素之谜终于被他们揭开，而塞缪尔森和他的老师贝里斯特伦也因此在1982年获得了诺贝尔医学奖，成功攀登了自然科学的最顶峰。
I think if I look back at my own career, I think it's been very useful to be associated with very good teachers.And I had especially two good teachers. One was the teacher I did my doctoral thesis with, my PhD, which was my mentor, Sune Bergström. And he was a professor here at the Karolinska, and originally he was professor at Lund University. Then I spent a year at Harvard University in 1961-62 and worked with a professor in organic chemistry, E.J. Corey. He taught me a lot about organic chemistry and science in general. It was very... So I would say get the right teachers,and go to the right places and work hard.
科学没有国界，卡罗林斯卡医学院的广阔胸怀向全世界的优秀人士敞开。目前学校拥有1300多名高级研究员和教员，300多名客座教授，在校生近万人，其中50%的学生来自国外，他们可以在大学提供19种专业，近200门独立课程中自由选择，每个科系都有10到20名教授引领学生步入医学知识的殿堂，长者的睿智和经验再次传递，年轻的激情和创新再次激发。
I moved up to Stockholm and I really enjoyed the atmosphere and the lab andthe quality of research up here in Karolinska Institute, and therefore I stayed here, ended my PhD studies, and now I'm doing a postdoc in this lab, and I really enjoy it, and I'm into never biology, and aging, and Alzheimer's, and it's really stimulating research to be in.
在这里你能感觉到一种更宽松的那种学术气氛，更友善的那种学习环境，就是说你无论是在你自己的组里，同事之间， 或者是跟老板的探讨之间，你都可以得到，就是都能感受到这样一种气氛。所以我觉得就是更鼓励人去自由的发挥，而不是说受到某些拘束。
任何一个社会都需要精英，把社会利益放在个人利益之上，把长远利益摆在短期利益之前，同时他们也愿意脚踏实地为实现理想而奋斗终生。这种书写大我的气概能为社会进步做出巨大的贡献，而卡罗林斯卡学院则为这些将来的精英提供着最优厚的福利与最丰富的资源。卡罗林斯卡学院的博士生无需通过勤工俭学来维持生计，而是从导师那里获得一定的学费和生活费。这种制度足以确保学生们衣食无忧，全力以赴地投入学习与科研。
我刚进入这个领域的时候可以说是没有什么背景知识，但是我到现在的时候，我一方面对这个领域，就对我所研究的课题越来越感兴趣，另一方面我觉得我也在逐步地成熟起来。
我们培养学生都是用精英的方法去培养，每一个人都很细致，我们去引导他，每个星期我们都跟他开会，分析他的结果。但是我们这不是像有的教授给你一个教授很多学生，但是没机会跟学生面对面的谈，去看他的结果。我们是每具体结果都有讨论，而是启发是让他自己去安排。我们知道你的结果，而不说你在做工作，你可以到外面去干你希望干的事情，但是你必须要给我机会。
关于实践的重要性，有古语云：耳闻之不如目见之，目见之不如足见之。卡罗林斯卡医学院深谙此道，特别注重动手能力培养，在大学各个医院建立了多个临床知识中心，将不同专业的教师和学生联系起来，更是能让身处世界不同角落的学生共同研究一个仿真病人的梦想变成现实，使得创新的火花和泉涌的灵感在交流探索中尽情迸发。
这里的 professor 他经常鼓励你，就是开或者启发你，就是说一些自己的 idea。像我们组呢，就是我们老板呢，经常就鼓励我们每一个人，就是说，不管你写的好不好，都要写 project 去申请钱。也不管你写了拿多少钱是另外一回事，但是要鼓励你写，就是做这方面的研究。
We also introducing more and more electronic help for the students, so-called e-learning. And in our system, sometimes it's hard to find the patients, enough patients, as we say, for the young student. So therefore we have developed a fairly good, I should say, computer program that these younger ones can test. They meet the students on the screen, and then they have to put the right questions for this patient and go through all these steps, and we have different versions of that, and then either they write everything.
卡罗林斯卡医学院是诺贝尔生理学或医学奖的评审地、诞生地，每时每刻都挑战着人类的智慧极限。1977年，学院成立了诺贝尔奖评奖委员会，每年都由全院最优秀的50位教授从全球上千份提名中严格筛选出候选人，最后交由核心评委会的18名成员定夺。这样不遗余力地层层把关，目的都是为了捍卫诺贝尔奖的权威性，选出在医学方面真正开创新领域而改变人类命运的重大发现者。
We are now in the session room of the Nobel Assembly at the Karolinska Institute. And this is a room where we have all the discussions and evaluations and final voting for the Nobel Prize. And Karolinska is awarding this prize in physiology or medicine every year. And this is the room where that takes place.
全球医学界精英每年因诺贝尔奖聚集在卡罗林斯卡，向世人阐述自己的科研成果对人类的影响。沐浴在诺贝尔奖的阳光下，卡罗林斯卡医学院不仅可以了解到最前沿的知识和先进独创的科学思维，而且可以营造一个富有激励性的环境，让学生积极与世界各地的著名科学家交流互动，从而扩大专业视野，开拓科研思维。
我们希望学生有机会的话，诺贝尔奖金的贺先嘴的那种讲座都要去听，为了鼓励他们去听，我们都有累积的分数制，来，比如说你一个学期下来听了好多，那么我们会给他有0.1分、0.5分，因为总的我他必须要修课20分，所以他必须要每天每个时间不断去接受新的教育，除了你的本身的研究范围之内，你必须要扩大你的思路到其他学科去，要听听其他人怎么讲，这样呢你才会扩散你的思路。
这种教育方式呢，就是鼓励人去运用自己获得的知识，然后呢去创造出新的东西来。
卡罗林斯卡医学院是瑞典医学教育科研的圣殿，承担着瑞典大约30%的医学教育和40%以上的医学研究任务。学校有3000多名研究人员和数百名来自世界各地的优秀学者，顶尖学者的持续对话，新鲜血液的不断补充，使卡罗林斯卡医学院走出了一条求新求变的可持续发展之路。在神经生物学、药理学、人类基因学等一系列重要领域，卡罗林斯卡医学院正以饱满从容的领导者姿态走在国际水平最前端。
That we are world leading in neuroscience concerning diagnostic possibilities. We are world leading in research concerning finding new targets for therapy. We are really good, I wouldn't say perhaps world leading when it's aboutcaring research to make it good quality of life for the patients.
It's very good for neuroscience research because there are a lot of very, very good neuroscientists at the Karolinska Institute, so it's good to interact and it's good to touch base with those and to discuss different ideas and different possibilities, you know, for collaboration. But it's a very stimulating research environment in that respect.
作为一个高福利国家，瑞典的公共医疗服务系统十分完备，而瑞典公民也有着积极参加医学临床试验的传统。这为卡罗林斯卡医学院建立全世界最庞大、最完备的国民医疗信息数据库提供了可能。1958年，癌症研究启动，特殊病例记录开始定期更新。半个世纪以来，900万瑞典人的医疗信息被连续实时地记录在一个庞大的数据库中，为流行病学、癌症、基因学等医学研究提供了宝贵的数据。
As a medical university, you have to have a very close interaction between the healthcare system and the research. And both Karolinska Institute and I would say also the Swedish healthcare system.Provides excellent opportunities for close interaction between patient close research and basic research. And actually, one can say that the conditions for translational research, we define it as translational research, when you go from the lab bench to the patient, the conditions may actually be among the best in the world in Sweden.
For epidemiology research, Sweden is a gold mine.And as a part of this, we also now are striving for to building up one of the biggest biobank efforts in the world. And we are trying to now get a project going on that is called LifeGene. LifeGene is supposed to follow 500,000 Swedes for more than 30 years
And the important thing is, of course, to follow people when they are healthy and are feeling very well. And then during the time, during lifespan, they will become sick and dead. And we try to understand why, to back the tape.
学院一方面全面调用社会资源来支撑自己的研究，另一方面对社会的责任感和对人类的终极关怀一直驱动着卡罗林斯卡医学院勇往直前。目前学院每年在世界顶级医疗刊物上发表论文超过4000篇，在干细胞、流行病学与肿瘤研究等领域走在国际前沿。同时学院与斯德哥尔摩郡议会合作开发了诺沃姆项目，专为大学与企业研究团体的创造性合作而设计，为的就是能实现生物医学创新性研究与生产技术的结合。
That the research we are doing really can't just stop when we have made a discovery. You have to continue then to think about how can we develop this to new treatment or something which is of benefit for the patient. And so what we are really building to be docked into our university is an innovation system where our scientists and researchers really can commercialize their ideas and their discoveries so it can be a product, a new drug, a new treatment. And that is very important for us.
We have created an innovation system that consists of two different parts. The first part is called Karolinska Innovations. Karolinska Innovations is sort of the interface towards the researcher. We meet all the researchers that want to come to us and present their ideas. We discuss the ideas and we're looking at what to do with them, what's possible. And those ideas that seem to be the most promising, we will also do some kind of evaluation or a due diligence process on them. So the second part of the system is basically an investment company, which is called Karolinska Development. Karolinska Development is a seed financer, which means that we will invest in very early companies such as these.
到目前为止，卡罗林斯卡医学院已评估了350多个项目，先后建立了30多家公司，同时也成为学院的经济支柱。国际化多元化的学术传统对卡罗林斯卡医学院而言不仅仅是一种气度和胸怀，更是一种实实在在的竞争力和策略。目前学校在10个研究领域拥有世界卫生组织合作中心的地位，而且与世界各地的250多所大学和研究中心签订了科研和教育方面的协议。
We have a number of joint scientific projects with China, particularly in the area of cancer, infectious diseases, public health, diabetes, AIDS, research, hearing research, to give you a few examples. I could give many more. We have 5 professors in the Karolinska, which are also visiting professors in Chinese universities today. We have trained in Karolinska Institute until today about 160 Chinese-born PhD students. Lately, over the past 2 or 3 years, several of these students have returned to China and established their own laboratories.
这边是以这个研究论文作为一个毕业答辩的一个先决条件，而你研究论文呢，他又要你半数以上发表，那这样呢，要让这个论文通过发表，那就不是导师一个人所能决定的，那就涉及到多国的这个国外的这个论文的评审。
在卡罗林斯卡医学院放眼全球的视野中，中国一直是其关注的焦点之一。早在上世纪70年代，与中国建立了联系，并于1986年正式开展合作项目。目前，卡罗林斯卡医学院与北京大学、复旦大学、四川大学等高校及研究所之间建立了联系。在展开医学领域各层次的研究交流之时，友谊和理解之花也在两国年轻人的心中悄然盛开。
In our strategies, the strategies reaching to 2010, we are really emphasizing excellence and quality. And that is very important for us, that to really be excellent in everything we're doing. We just have to have a system in place which ensures that we have quality in our undergraduate programs, we have excellence in our postgraduate programs, in the PhD programs, in all the research we are doing.
卡罗林斯卡医学院就像一个具有活力的超级立场，吸引着天才的研究者、博学的教学者、优秀的学习者以及慷慨的投资者。肩负诺贝尔医学奖的优良传统，坚持以人为本的价值取向，实践踏实、沉稳之风的卡罗林斯卡医学院，还将继续奏出医学领域的世界最强音。